Hello students, myself Mrs. Renuka Badgujar, and today I am going to explain chapter 2 of Honeycomb. The title of your chapter is The Gift of Chappals, written by Vasantha Surya. This story is about the mischievous and simplicity of children's behavior. They wish to explore every aspect but act according to their own logic. They gave chappals to the beggar and then to the music teacher without hesitation. Their sensitive hearts melt easily. Children's minds are much simpler than those of grown-ups. So in the chapter, we will read about the meetings of Mridu, Ravi, Meena and Rukumani. We will read about the chappals around which the whole story lingered. The children's love for animals, brother-sister's behavior, the impact of elders of the house on children, about childhood and kindness. Okay, so in this chapter, we will be reading about all these things. So here we start with our chapter. Chapter 2, that is A Gift of Chappals, written by Vasantha Surya. Mridu is a young girl growing up in Madras, now called Chennai, with Tapi, her grandmother, and Tata, her grandfather. One afternoon, Tapi takes her to her aunt Rukumani's house to meet her cousins Lalli, Ravi, and Meena. So here in this chapter, we have these characters. Mridu, she is the main character of this chapter. She is a young girl and she lived in Madras, now it is called Chennai, with her Tapi. Tapi means grandmother in Tamil language, and Tata. Tata means grandfather. Means she lived in Madras with her grandparents. One afternoon, Tapi takes her to her aunt Rukumani's house to meet her cousins Lalli, Ravi, and Meena. Okay, so with grandparents, Mridu visited her aunt and her cousins. So now we start with the chapter. A smiling Rukumani threw open the door. Ravi and Meena rushed out and Ravi pulled Mridu into the house. "Wait, let me take off my slippers," protested Mridu. She set them out neatly near a pair of large black ones. Those were grey, actually with dust. You could see the clear mark of every toe on the front part of each slipper. The marks for the two big toes were long and scrawny. So here, when Mridu reached at her aunt's house, smiling Rukumani threw open the door. Rukumani opens the door very quickly. And Ravi and Meena, they are Mridu's cousins. They just rushed out. They came out quickly from inside the house and Ravi pulled Mridu into the house. At this, Mridu protested. Mridu objected. She wanted to take off her slippers. So she left her slippers with a pair of large black ones. Okay, so where she put her slippers? Near a large pair of black slippers. And these chappals, these slippers were grey. Actually, they were covered with dust. And you could see the clear marks of every toe on the front part of each slipper. Means these slippers were so old. The marks for the two big toes were long and scrawny. And on those chappals, the footprints, the mark of each toe and finger was clearly seen. And the marks of the two toes, they were very big and thin. Mridu didn't have much time to wonder about whose slippers they were, because Ravi dragged her to the backyard behind a thick bitterberry bush. There, inside a torn football lined with sacking and filled with sand, lay a very small kitten lapping up milk from a coconut half shell. So when Ravi dragged Mridu inside the house, where he take her? He take Mridu at the back side of his house behind a thick bitterberry bush. So when they were moving from the veranda, Mridu didn't have much time to get astonished, to get surprised about whose slippers they were, those old slippers. So when they were reached at the backside, what they find? They find one kitten, and it was lying in an old football. It was torn, and inside the football one sack was lined, and it was filled with sand, and the kitten was lying inside that torn football very comfortably, and it was sipping milk from a coconut half shell. We found him outside the gate this morning. He was mewing and mewing. Poor thing, said Meena. It's a secret. Amma says Pati will leave for our Paddu Mama's house if she knows we have a cat. So here in this picture you can see that a cat is lying inside the torn football, inside the old football. See what Ravi and Meena says about this kitten. They told about this kitten to Mridu that they found this kitten outside the gate this morning, and he was mewing and mewing. It's a secret. This thing has not to be told to grandmother, because grandmother has warned them that if she find anything like a kitten or any pet inside the house, she will leave the house for Paddu Mama's house. People are always telling us to be kind to animals, but when we are, they scream, "Oh, don't bring that dirty creature here," said Ravi. "Do you know how hard it is just to get a little milk from the kitchen? Pati saw me with a glass in my hand just now. I told her I'm very hungry. I want to drink it, but the way she looked at me, I had to drink most of it to throw her off the scent. Then she wanted the tumbler back. Pati, Pati, I'll wash it myself. Why should I put you to trouble?" I told her. So here Ravi continues with her talk, what he wanted to tell Mridu. He says that people are always telling us, means people always teach the children, the kids, to help other, to be kind to animals. But when we are, means when we are kind to the animals, and when we keep them inside our house, they scream. What they say? They say, "Oh, don't bring that dirty creature here." So at this, Ravi says, further says that, "Do you know how hard it is just to get a little milk from the kitchen?" So here in this line, he is telling about his struggle, that how much he is struggling to feed this little kitten. So when he has to feed this little kitten, he has to tell lies to his Pati. Once he was taking milk for this kitten, Pati saw him with a glass of milk in his hand. So at this, he told her that he was hungry and he wanted to drink the milk. So the way that she looked at him, he had to drink most of the milk to make her mislead, so that she won't understand the real purpose. So at this, he told the Pati, his Pati, when the little milk left inside the tumbler, the glass, that, "Pati, I will wash this tumbler myself. I don't want to trouble you." So I told her I had to run and pour the milk into the coconut shell, and then run back and wash the tumbler and put it back before she got really suspicious. Now we have to think of some other way to feed Mahindran. So what he did when Pati saw him with the glass of milk, he had to drink most of it. And when he convinced his grandmother, his Pati, that he will wash the tumbler himself, then he ran to the kitchen at backyard to pour the left milk in the coconut shell so that the kitten get feed. So he is telling that he managed everything before his Pati got really suspicious, and now he is saying that they have to think some other way to feed Mahindran. Mahindran,
This little kitty's name is Mahindran. Mridu was impressed. It was a real name, not just a cute kitty cat name. So when Mridu heard the name of this little kitten, she got impressed. She says, Mahindran, they have named this little cute kitty as Mahindran. Actually, his full name is Mahindra Verma Pallava Punnai. MP Punnai for short, if you like. He is a fine beard. He is a fine breed of cat. Just look at his fur, like a lion's mane. And you know what the emblem of the ancient Pallava kings was, don't you? He looked expectantly at Mridu. So, at this, this Ravi, he says further that actually this kitten's name, its full name is Mahindra Verma Pallava Punnai. And if she likes, she can call this kitten as MP Punnai. And he started praising his cat, that he is a fine breed of cat. And he started praising his fur also, that his fur looked like a lion's mane. Mane is the growth of hair around the neck, just as a lion has, the horse has. So he is praising the fur of kitten. And you know what the emblem of the ancient Pallava kings was, don't you? He looked expectantly at Mridu. So here he is praising his kitten and he is just being exaggerating. And for this, he asks some question related to history to Mridu. Mridu giggled. So when Ravi said all this, Mridu just laughed. Think I'm joking? Well, just wait. I'll show you sometime. It's clear you don't know a thing about history. Haven't been to Mahabalipuram, have you? He said mysteriously. So when Ravi asked about the emblem of the ancient Pallava king, Mridu giggled. So Ravi says that you are thinking that I'm joking. So he says that I will show you sometime. And when Mridu was not able to answer this question, he says that you are very weak at history. She don't know anything about history. So at this, Ravi says that haven't you been to Mahabalipuram? When our class went to Mahabalipuram, I saw a statue of his thathas, etc., etc. Fact is, Mahindran here is descendant from that very same ancient cat, a close relative, scientifically speaking, of none other than the lion, the Pallava lion, emblem of the Pallava dynasty. Ravi went on walking around the bitter berry bush, waving a twig up and down, his eyes sparkling. This cat is descendant of none other than the Mahabalipuram Rishi cat. And if I may just remind you, they worshipped cats in ancient Egypt. So here in these lines, Ravi is just praising his kitten and he is just making some stories so that Mridu will believe on his story. So what he is saying, that this Mahindran, this cat, is the descendant of Rishi cat, which statue he found there in Mahabalipuram, and it was one of the statue of thathas, etc., means of their forefathers. How he loved the sound of his own voice. Meena and Mridu exchanged looks. So when Ravi was telling all these stories, Meena and Mridu, they just exchanged look. They just look at each other, that what he is saying, is this relevant to anything? So what does that have to do with anything? Mridu demanded. So Mridu asked that whatever you are telling, the stories that you are telling, is it relevant? What does that have to do with anything? I'm telling you, this cat is descended from the Egyptian cat god, no goddess Bastet. Yeah, that's it. So here again, this Ravi, he is just praising his cat. And here he ended with his praising. So, well, one of the descendants of that cat goddess was a stowaway in one of the Pallava ships. And his descendant was the Mahabalipuram Rishi cat, whose descendant is Ravi flourished his twitch at Mahindran. MB Pune here. Whoop, eek. He shrieked, very pleased with himself. So he is just making some stories so that Mridu believe on a story that this cat is the descendant of the Rishi cat. Mahindran looked up, alarmed. He had just been sharpening his claws on the edge of the coconut shell. But worse than Ravi's awful whoop, eek, was a screech from the window. What a weird sound. If Mridu was startled, MP Punnai was frightened out of his wits. Hair standing on end, he bounced up and scurried towards a bamboo tray of red chilies that had been set out to dry. Trying to hide beneath it, he tipped a few chilies over himself. Meow, he howled miserably. So, at this, when Ravi was talking about this cat, he looked up. Mahindran looked up. He was alarmed. He was alert. And he just started sharpening his claws on the edge of the coconut shell. But worse than Ravi's awful whoop, eek, was a screech. There was another weird sound, screech, from the window. And what a weird sound it is. If Mridu was startled, MP Punnai was frightened out of his wits. Hair standing on end, he bounced up and scurried towards a bamboo tray of red chilies that had been set out to dry. So, after hearing these weird sounds, this little cat, Mahindran, he got frightened. And to hide himself, he just started running. And when he was trying to hide himself, he tipped a few chilies over himself. At this, he cried bitterly, meow. The screeching went on and on. What's that noise? Said Mridu. That's Lalli learning to play the violin, grunted Ravi. So after hearing this weird sound, Mridu also asked about this sound, that what kind of this screeching sound. So at this, Ravi told that this is Lalli. And she is learning to play the violin. She'll never learn a thing. The music master just goes on playing like a train whizzing on and on, while Lalli is all the time derailing, going completely off track. See, what Ravi is saying, that Lalli is never going to learn playing violin. The music teacher is playing the notes very beautifully. He is on the track. His notes are on the track. He is playing it very beautifully. While Lalli is all the time derailing, means she is not at all on the track, going completely off track. So Mridu crept up to the window. Lalli was sitting a little distance away, awkwardly holding her violin and bowstring, her elbows jutting out and her eyes glazed with concentration. In front of her, with most of his back to the window, was the bony figure of the music master. He had a mostly bald head with a fringe of oiled black hair falling around his ears and an old-fashioned tuft. A gold chain gleamed around his leathery neck and a diamond ring glittered on his hand as it glided up and down the stem of the violin. A large foot stuck out from beneath his gold-bordered vesti edge, and he was beating time on the floor with the scrawny big toe. So here, after hearing the screeching sound, Mridu just moved slowly to the window from where this screeching sound was coming. So what they found there inside that window, when they were peeping through the window, what they found? Lalli was sitting a little distance away, and she was holding the violin awkwardly with its bowstring. Her elbow was just jutting out and her eyes glazed with concentration. She was sitting there with full of concentration, and she was sitting there awkwardly in front of her with most of his back to the window was the bony figure of the music master. So just in front of her, at the back of the window, the music master was sitting, and he had a mostly bald head, means he had a few hair on his head. means he was bald-headed with a fringe of oiled black hair falling around his ears and so few hair that he had on his head. He put oil on those hairs and her hair were just falling around his ears, and he was wearing an old-fashioned tuft. A gold chain gleamed around his leathery neck, means he is old, and a gold chain it was gleaming around his neck, and the diamond ring glittered on his hand as it glided up and down the stem of the violin. So when he was playing the violin with the stem, he was just showing his diamond rings, and it was just glittering with the movement of his hands. And a large foot stuck out from beneath his gold bordered vesti edge, and he was wearing a vesti that he was wearing on his lower part of the body. And when he was playing the violin, he was beating time on the floor with the scrawny big toe. He played a few notes. Who is he? Here he is, the music master. He played a few notes. Lully stumbled behind him on her violin, which looked quite helpless and unhappy in her hands. So this music master, he played a few notes to teach Lully, and when Lully tried those notes, she just got stumbled, means she was not very proper, she was not very much good on those notes. So at this, it was looking very helpless. What a difference! The music master's notes seemed to float up and settle perfectly into the invisible track of the melody. It was like the wheels of a train fitting smoothly into the rail and whizzing along. As Ravi said, Mridu stared at the huge, bearded hand moving effortlessly up the violin stem, making lovely music. So here, the difference between the music master and Lully could be seen clearly. Music master was so perfect in making notes, while Lully was so unprofessional, she was so improper. Squack! There was Lully derailing again. So when Lully tried again, another screeching sound, another weird sound came. It was squack. Amma! Came a wail from the gate. Amma! Oh! So when Lully was trying to make these notes, a very poor sound came from the gate. It was a very painful cry, grief of anger. So a sound that has pain, it came from the gate. Amma, oh Amma. Ravi, send that the beggar away. Ravi, send that beggar away, cried the mother from the back veranda where she was chatting with Tapi. So when Ravi's mother heard this voice, Amma, oh Amma, what she said to Ravi? She just cried from inside the house to send him away, and she was chatting with Tapi, and Tapi is grandmother in Tamil language. He has been coming here every day for the past week, and it's time he found another house to beg from, Pati explained to Tapi. Okay, so at this, when Ravi's mother told Ravi to send this beggar away, Pati explained to Tapi that he has been coming here every day for the past week. Okay, so he is coming for the past week, and it's time he found another house to beg from. So now he should find another house to beg. Mridu and Meena followed Ravi out. The beggar was already in the garden, making himself quite at home. He had spread his upper cloth under the neem tree. He was leaning against its trunk, apparently prepared to take a little snooze while he waited for the ants to appear. Go away, said Ravi sternly. My Pati says it's time you found another house to beg from. So when Ravi was going outside to move away this beggar, Mridu and Meena, they were following Ravi. So the beggar, when they came out, the beggar was already in the garden. and he made himself very much quite at home. He made him very much comfortable. He had spread his upper cloth under the neem tree and was leaning against its trunk. He was in mood to get rest there under the neem tree, apparently prepared to take a little snooze while he waited for the ants to appear. So he was just hoping for a little nap while the ants to appear. Means when until Ravi or somebody from the inside, they bring something as am, he wanted to get a snooze. So when Ravi reached outside, he said, "Go away. My Pati says it's time you found another house to beg from. Move away from this house." The beggar opened his eyes very wide and gazed at each of the children one by one. "The ladies of this house," he said at last in a voice choked with feeling, "are very kind souls. I have kept my body and soul together on their generosity for a whole week. I cannot believe that they would turn me away." He raised his voice. "Amma, Amma, oh," said his wail might be, but it certainly wasn't feeble. It began in a deep, strong rumble somewhere in his withered belly and came booming out of his mouth with its few remaining teeth stained brown with beetle chewing. So when Ravi told him to move away, he said that the ladies of this house can't be so rude. They are so kind and they have been feeding him for last whole week. And he is very much overwhelmed with their generosity. And he is saying that he can't believe that they would turn him away. At this, he again raised his voice, "Amma, Amma." So, in these lines, the description of this beggar is given, and how he cried, it is also clearly given. Ravi tell him there is nothing left in the kitchen called Rukmani, and he is not to come again. Tell him that. She sounded fed up. Ravi didn't have to repeat it at all to the beggar. What his mother said had been easy for them all to hear. There under the neem tree, the beggar sat up and sighed. So when this beggar was not moving away, Rukmani just shouted in from inside the house. Means she was just totally fed up. When she shouted to tell Ravi that, tell him there is nothing left in the kitchen, she was so loud that everybody, those who were there under that neem tree, these three children and this beggar, they heard it very properly. At this, the beggar sat up and sighed. I'll go, he said wearily. Only let me have a rest here under this tree. The sun is so hot. The tar has melted on the road. So at this, this beggar says that, okay, I'll go. He was tired. He said wearily, means he said very, he was very tired. So he just said that, I want to just take some rest under this tree. The sun is so hot. It is so hot out there, and the tar has melted on the road. My feet are already blistered. He stretched out his feet to show large pink peeling blisters on the soles of his bare feet. So he is a beggar. He had nothing to wear in his foot. So he was walking barefoot on the roads in this hot day. So because he was walking barefoot in this sunny day in this warm day, so his feet got blisters and they were pink peeling. So I suppose he doesn't have the money to buy chappals, Mridu whispered to Meena Ravi. Have you got an old pair in the house somewhere? So when these children saw his blisters, Mridu whispered to Meena and Ravi that, I think he doesn't have money to buy chappals. So Mridu at this asked to these her cousins that, have you got any old pair in the house somewhere so that they can help this beggar? I don't know, said Ravi. Mine are too small to fit his feet, or I'd have given them to him. And His feet were larger than Mridu's and Meena's. So when Mridu asked for any old pair of slippers in the house, at this Ravi says that he don't know about any old pair of slippers, but he says that his own slippers are too small for his large foot, and Mridu's and Meena's chappals will also not be get fitted in his feet. The beggar was shaking out his upper cloth and tightening his dhoti. He raised his eyes and looked fearfully at the road, gleaming in the afternoon heat. So now the beggar is getting ready to start his walk, to start moving from that shadow of the tree. And he was very much frightened by looking at the road and by looking at the sunny day. It was so hot. He needs something on his feet, Meena said, her big eyes filling. It's not fair. So when Meena saw that this beggar is going away, he is just going to start his walk on that hot road, at this Meena's eyes filled with tears. She says that he needs something on his feet. It's not fair that he is going to walk barefoot without slippers. Shh, said Ravi. I'm thinking about it. Blubbering. It's not fair. It's not fair. Isn't going to help. In 2 minutes, I'll be frying his feet on that road. What he needs is a pair of chappals. So where do we get them? Come, let's search the house. He pushed Mridu and Meena into the house. So these children are getting worried for this beggar that his feet are already having blisters and again he has to walk barefoot on this road. So they just want to find any pair of slippers for this beggar. So they went inside the house to find any pair of the slippers. Just as she stopped into the veranda, Mridu's eyes fell on the odd-looking chappals she had noticed when she arrived. Ravi, she whispered to him, whose are those? So when they were just moving inside the house, at that very time, Mridu's eyes fell on these weird-looking chappals, these old chappals that she just noticed when she reached at their house, when she put off her own slippers, and she kept her slippers near these pair of slippers. So at this she asked to Ravi that whose are those? Ravi turned and glanced at the shabby looking but sturdy old slippers. He beamed and nodded. These are just the right size, he said, picking them up. Mridu and Meena followed him nervously back into the garden. So at this Ravi just gave a look on these slippers. He said that these are very old chappals and he don't know whose chappal are those, but he said that these are just the right size. They will be the perfect slippers for the beggar. So they just, Mridu and Meena followed Ravi nervously back into the garden where the beggar was standing. Here, said Ravi to the beggar, dropping the slippers in front of the old man. Wear these and don't come back. The beggar stared at the slippers, hurriedly flung his towel over his shoulder, pushed his feet into them and left, muttering a blessing to the children. In a minute, he had vanished around the corner of the street. So, when Ravi, along with his cousins, he came there with the slippers, with the pair of the slippers, and they dropped these slippers in front of the old man and instructed him to wear these slippers and just move away and don't come back. And they instructed him to not to come back. So the beggar stared at the slippers. He was surprised. He just gazed at the slippers. What he wanted more. So he just found the slippers in front of her eyes. He just got very much happy. Hurriedly he just flung his towel over his shoulder and pushed his feet into them. Means he just wear these slippers very quickly and left, muttering blessings to the children. He gave so many blessings to the children and in a minute he had vanished around the corner of the street. He vanished because he thought that these children have just brought these slippers. What would happen if anybody else come from inside the house? He could have to give these slippers back. So he just vanished after having these slippers and he was so happy. The music master came out of the house and took an unappreciative look at the three of them sitting quietly under the tree playing marbles. Then he searched for his chappals in the veranda where he had put them. So after this, the music teacher came out of the house and he just gave an unappreciative look at these three children because they were playing the marbles. And after giving that look, he started searching his slippers, his chappals in veranda where he had put them. Lalli, he called. After a few moments, she hurried up to him. Have you seen my chappals, my dear? I remember having kept them here. So when he didn't find his chappals there in veranda, he called Lalli, and after a few moments, she hurriedly came there. And at this, music master asked question to Lalli that, have you seen my chappals, my dear? I remember having kept them here. That he just kept his slippers there in the veranda only. Ravi, Mridu and Meena silently watched Lalli and the music master search every corner of the veranda. He scurried around, looking over the railing and crouching near the flower pots to look between them. Brand new they were. I went all the way to Mount Road to buy them. He went on saying, they cost a whole month's fees, do you know? So when Lalli and this music master, they were searching for the chappals in every corner of the house, he was just telling lie. He was telling lie about his slippers. He understood that he is not getting his slippers there. He is not able to find the slippers there. So he started just telling lie about his slippers, that they were brand new. And he just bought those slippers from the Mount Road. He went to Mount Road to buy those chappals. And what it cost? They cost a whole month's fees. Soon Lalli went in to tell her mother. Rukumani appeared, looked harassed, with Pati following her. So when music master didn't find his slipper, so Lalli and her mother, they both were embarrassed. Where could they be? It's really quite upsetting to think someone might have stolen them. So many vendors come to the door, worried Pati. So at this, Pati says that where could they be? Means so many vendors come. Vendors are the small sellers, the sellers that comes door to door and they sell their things. So many vendors come to the door and they might have stolen the slippers. Rukmani caught sight of Ravi, Mridu and Meena sitting under the tree. Have you children? She began, and then seeing they were curiously quiet, went on more slowly. Seen anyone lurking around the veranda? A sharp V-shaped line had formed between her eyebrows. Another straight, tighter one appeared in place of her usually soft, pleasant mouth. Rukmani was angry, thought Mridu with a shiver. She wouldn't be so upset if she knew about the poor beggar with sores on his feet. She tried to tell herself. So when the music master didn't get his slippers, and Lalli and Rukmani, they both were embarrassed because music master has just lost his slippers on their house. At this, when Rukmani saw these three children, Mridu, Ravi and Meena, sitting under the tree, she gave a very angry look to them and asked about the slipper, that did they saw anyone moving around the veranda. So she was very angry because they were not telling about the slipper and the music teacher didn't get the slippers. So at this, Ravi thought that she would not be so angry if she will know about this beggar. Taking a deep breath, she cried, Rukmani, there was a beggar here. Poor thing, he had such boils on his feet. So, said Rukmani grimly, turning to Ravi, You gave the music master's chapel to that old beggar who turned up here. So when they told about this beggar that he had sores on his feet, so after listening this, Rukumani interrogated them. She asked that, so they just gave the music master chappals to this beggar. Children these days, groaned Pati. Amma, didn't you tell me about Karna, who gave away everything he had, even his gold earrings? He was so kind and generous. So when everybody knew that these children has given these chappals to that beggar, they were not quite happy. So at this, Ravi says that, Amma, didn't you tell us about Karna? Karna is the character from Mahabharata who was famous for his generosity, who gave away everything he had, even his gold earrings. He was so kind and generous. Silly, snapped Rukumani. Karna didn't give away other people's things. He only gave away his own. So at this, Rukumani told him that Karna didn't give any other people things. He just gave his own things. But my chappals wouldn't have fitted the beggar's feet, Ravi rushed brashly on. And Amma, if they did fit, would you really not have minded? So at this, when Rukumani told her that Karna gave only his own belongings, Ravi says that my chappals wouldn't have fitted the beggar's feet. And if they did fit, would you really not have minded? If he would have gave his own slippers, did she really don't scold him? Ravi said Rukumani, very angry now, go inside this minute. She hurried indoors and brought out Gopu Mama's hardly worn new chappals. These should fit you, sir. Please put these on. I'm so sorry. My son has been very naughty. The music master's eyes lit up. He put them on, trying not to look too happy. Well, I suppose these will have to do. These days, children have no respect for elders. What to do? A human incarnate, only Ram can save such a naughty fellow. Rukumani's eyes flashed. She didn't seem to like Ravi being called a monkey, even a holy monkey. She stood stiff and straight by the front door. It was clear she wanted him to leave quickly. So when everybody knew that Ravi, Mridu and Mani has given these slippers to the beggar, at this Rukumani got very much embarrassed as well as angry. So she just went inside the house to bring Gopu Mama slippers. They were brand new, hardly worn, and she just gave those chappals to the music master. So at this, music master was so happy, because at the place of that old pair of slippers, he is getting now a brand new slippers. But he did not want to show his happiness. He just pretended that he is not very much happy. So he says that these days children have no respect for elders. What to do? And he says that a Hanuman incarnate, only Ram can save such a naughty fellow. So when Rukumani says that his son has been naughty, so music master calls him Hanuman. But Rukumani's eyes flashed. She did not seem to like Ravi being called a monkey, even a holy monkey. So she just stood stiff and straight by the front door. It was clear she wanted him to leave quickly. When he had clattered off in his new chappals, she said, Mridu, come in and have some tiffin. Honestly, how do you children think of such things? Thank God, your Gopu Mama doesn't wear his chappals to work. As she walked towards the kitchen with Mridu and Meena, she suddenly began to laugh. But he is always in such a hurry to throw off his shoes and socks and get into chappals as soon as he comes home. What's your Mama going to say this evening when I tell him I gave his chappals to the music master? So when this music master left, and at this, Rukumani says that, Mridu, come in and have some tiffin. She offered her to have some to eat. So at this, she says that, you people, how you just think all of these things? But thank God that Gopu Mama does not wear his chappals to work. But when he will come back, he is in a habit to put off his shoes and socks and get into his chappals as soon as he comes home. So now she is laughing that when he will come home, when he will return home, what she is going to tell him, that what's your mama going to say this evening when I tell him that I gave his chappals to the music master. So now she is ready to take this blame on her. So now at the end of the chapter, two people were gifted with the slippers. One was the beggar and here the music master. Okay, so I hope that the chapter is clear to you.